So I hear a lot of beginner to intermediate jazz solos that sound like this. Before I go on and show you a more professional sounding jazz solo, let's first talk about what's wrong with this first one. Because on the face of it, there's actually some good notes being played there, and I'm even hitting chord tones, so it sounds like I'm playing the chord changes. But ultimately, there are two things that are critically wrong that's making this jazz solo sound amateur. First, let's take a look here at this first phrase. So it goes, and you'll notice that the next phrase goes like this. And the next phrase goes, which leads us to the first problem, is this. We have basically phrases that are constantly starting on the downbeats. Therefore, everything just kind of sounds like it's landing on one all the time, and that's really not what great jazz musicians are doing. In a second, I'll show you what great jazz musicians are doing. But when you listen through this, it's just painfully clear that every single phrase starting on a downbeat sounds incredibly redundant and ultimately kind of boring. Now that leads us to the second problem with this solo, which is this. We have a phrase right here, which is kind of connected to this next phrase right here, but since we're using larger subdivisions like quarter notes, it does feel like its own separate phrase. Then we have another short phrase, another short phrase, another short phrase, and then another short phrase here, here, and finally here. So again, listening to these first three lines, it sounds like this. And then continuing on. So really broken up short phrases. Now, honestly, that's not a bad way to start a solo. It's not really always a good idea to start guns blazing with lots of notes. You'll hear Miles Davis play a lot like this, but what I hear from a lot of beginner jazz players is this tendency to do this for an entire chorus, and then another chorus, and then another chorus, and that's not really what professional jazz musicians are doing. So what are professional jazz musicians doing? Well, take a listen to this pro-level jazz solo that uses some similar themes to the beginner one. Sounded a lot better, right? Well, you may think, oh, that's because you played more beboppy lines and more isms that you would hear in popular jazz language. Yes, we added some of that in there, but it would have been impossible to do with the beginner jazz solo playing the short choppy phrases and everything on the downbeats. So let's take a look here at the first two bars here of this pro jazz solo. So we're playing a jazz blues here. So we start on B7, and it starts on the and of one, so one. Right? Just like that. So automatically we're adding what's called syncopation, right? We're starting not on the downbeat, we're starting on the end of one. Now leading in to the E7 here, we start with a pickup. We start the line on the end of four, right? We're not just starting the line on beat one, we're starting on the end of four. That's the sound that a lot of jazz musicians are going for. Now listen to the next two bars over top of the next B7. Sounds like this. Notice how this line here ends on the end of two and ties into beats three and four. So when you look throughout this solo, there are different examples here of how we're not starting on the beat one or always on downbeats, we're starting and ending on offbeats. So for example, right here in the B7, we actually end the line on the end of one. We have an ornamental pickup here leading into this G7 six chord. At the end of the solo, we actually end the whole line on the end of four before the last chord is actually even played. This is very common in jazz. Now we'll talk about some strategies of how to address this, but let's look at the next thing in this jazz solo that is fixed from the beginner jazz solo, which is the longer flowing eighth note lines. Now we do have some space between phrases. For example, right here, there's a space. Over here, we can call this a space because it's a longer subdivision, and then it's followed by a two-beat rest. And then over here, another two-beat rest. So there is definitely space in this solo for sure. But oftentimes what you want to hear is, yes, smaller broken up phrases, but then every once in a while, give the listener a little bit of a relief with a longer flowing eighth note line. For example, let's look right here with this ornamental pickup that's going into the G7 6 chord. Right, so that line there, it's a longer flowing eighth note line that literally spans for 1, 2, 3 bars. It gives the listener relief from shorter chopped up phrases. I encourage you to go listen to some of your favorite jazz musicians and hear how they do this. For example, Sonny Rollins' solo on St. Thomas, he starts his solo really rhythmic, smaller broken up phrases, but then all of a sudden he'll break out into a longer flowing eighth note line and it just sounds incredible to your ears. So the question you've been waiting for, how do I get better at playing longer flowing eighth note lines and not playing every single phrase starting on the downbeat? Let's start with a simple exercise I often give to my inner circle members for practicing playing longer flowing eighth note lines. So exercise one is called the continuous subdivision exercise. So the exercise goes like this. First, let's start with a very simple subdivision that is easy to play, right? So let's do half notes. Let's do half notes for one whole chorus over top of the blues. So let's improvise, and it sounds like this. Simple to start, right? So now let's move on to quarter notes. Awesome. So we're getting used to playing continuous subdivisions throughout a whole song form. Now, here's the money one. Let's go to continuous eighth notes over top of this blues. Continuous eighth notes, it's actually not that easy to do, especially if we're doing something longer than a 12 bar form, like a 32 bar form. And the idea of it isn't really to play the best lines ever. It's not really the idea to play the perfect notes. And sometimes it's actually acceptable, of course, to play the wrong notes. But the idea is to get used to playing those longer lines continuously in time with great groove and great time feel. And so the more you do this, you exaggerate the process, the more it's gonna become more natural for you to play those longer flowing eighth note lines that don't necessarily sound planned. They sound improvised and it sounds natural. So that's exercise one, the continuous subdivision exercise, the exaggerated process to help you start creating more longer flowing eighth note lines in your solos. Exercise number two is the offbeat phrase starter exercise, the offbeat phrase starter exercise, which obviously tackles the problem of playing only on the downbeats. So the idea behind this one is just to be very intentional and choose an offbeat that you want to start on, right? So any of the ands of one of the main downbeats that we're talking about, and certainly not starting on beat one. So a really simple one would be, let's just start lines and phrases on the end of one. So let me go ahead and start improvising, and I'm only going to be thinking about starting my phrases on the end of one, like this. ¶¶ starting most of the phrases there on the ands of one, right? And so it's okay too if we're kind of breaking our rules a little bit with playing the longer flowing eighth note lines here, because the purpose of this exercise is really to get used to playing on the ands of, right? And so we can change this exercise up too, right? We could play, let's start every single phrase on the and of four. We could start every single phrase on the and of three, right? And so by being very intentional about this, what you're doing is you're training your ears and your muscle memory to start playing more on these beats and feeling these beats internally rather than every single phrase on the downbeat. So by the way, if you're listening to all this and you're like, that's awesome, Brent, but I have zero idea how to improvise at all. Well, first of all, feel free to practice these things using scales or basic patterns at first. But second of all, definitely check out my free guide called The Jazz Improv Made Easy Fast Track Guide. I'll leave that down in the description as well as on the screen here in a second. It really kind of goes over some very basics of jazz improv. It's gonna get you started. It's completely free, and I know you're going to benefit a ton from it, just as thousands of others have. And finally, it's important to mention that these are only just two things that I hear that create kind of amateur sounding jazz solos. But I have a video on the screen right now that goes over 10 different things that may be making you sound still a little bit amateur, when just fixing a few of them could really get you on the path to sounding more like a jazz pro. So check that out on the screen right now. If you found value from this video, please hit the like button. Please subscribe to the channel, and we'll see you in the next one. Cheers.